Welcome back to Mad Medicine. In this lecture, we're going to be discussing an introduction to normocytic anemias. We have already done microcytic anemias on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/madmedicine, and there in a Hemonc playlist, you can watch all the videos for microcytic anemia and the causes of microcytic anemias. So go check that out. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to our channel because we are posting brand new content every single day, baby. Every single day. That's like clockwork. So anyways, let's have a little recap on anemia basics. Anemias are conditions where you don't have enough healthy red blood cells to carry enough oxygen to the tissue, and there are many causes of anemia. And we can break up anemia into two main classifications. You have the kinetic approach, and in the kinetic approach, you are looking at hemoglobin specifically. So if you have a decrease in hemoglobin, you will have an anemia, and this is all going to be decrease in production, in increase in destruction, destruction or loss of red blood cells. That's what's happening in the kinetic. But for step one and for these videos, we are going to be approaching this based off of the morphologic approach. Now, the morphologic approach is going to look at the RBC size, the red blood cell sizes. So you could have increase, you could have a decreased size, or you could have a normal size of red blood cell. And based off of this, there are three main types of anemias. You have microcytic anemia, you have normocytic anemia, which is a normal red blood cell, and then you have macrocytic anemia, a very large red blood cell like this right here. So when it comes to anemias, we have broken them down. We have already covered microcytic. In these lectures, we're going to be discussing normocytic anemias, and normocytic anemias can be subclassified based off of hemolysis and lack thereof hemolysis, and then hemolysis can be further broken down into intrinsic and extrinsic hemolysis. And then in our later videos, we will cover macrocytic anemias too. But for the next upcoming videos, we're going to be focusing on normocytic anemias. So let's talk about normocytic anemia. It is going to be classified based off of an MCV that is 80 to 100. Now, your hemoglobin, your hematocrit, MCH, MCHC can all be normal. This can vary. Keep that in mind. So I do want to put an asterisk. You can have low hemoglobin, but it usually can also come up as them being normal. So don't be confused that someone is having a normocytic anemia. Again, we are classifying this based off of the morphologic approach, and that specifically looks at the MCV values. MCV, that is the most important thing. Normocytic anemias can be subdivided based off of hemolysis, positive where you do have hemolysis or when you don't have hemolysis. And when you do have hemolysis in a hemolytic anemia, you can break it down into intrinsic and extrinsic causes, problems within the cell and outside of the cell. So non-hemolytic anemias are these right here. Aplastic anemia, chronic kidney disease can lead to a normocytic anemia that's non-hemolytic. You can also have anemia of chronic disease and early iron deficiency anemia. And we will talk about all these in depth. And then you have hemolytic causes of anemias, and there are several. There are so many for hemolytic causes. This is probably the most extensive portion when it comes to step one, and it's going to be the hemolytic anemias. Spend a good amount of time on all of these hemolytic anemias. Intrinsic hemolytic anemias are problems within the cell, so you can have membrane deficits, and let's write this down, within the cell, okay? So when you have problems within the cell, you can have problems within the membrane, you can have enzyme deficiencies, or you can have hemoglobinopathies, and all of these will lead to hemolysis of the red blood cell intrinsically. And then you have extrinsic causes of hemolysis, that occur outside of the cell, and these can be stuff like autoimmune hemolytic anemia, microangiopathic and macroangiopathic issues can cause it, and infections can also cause it. Now, when it comes to anemias in general, you need to understand reticulocyte count. This is very important because reticulocyte count tells you whether or not you have an anemia also happening and what type of anemia there could be happening. But mainly, it is used to measure bone marrow response if there's adequate bone marrow response in presence of an anemia. So right here, you see these abnormal red blood cells. They have this little basophilic stippling happening, and that's because you have nuclear remnants in the red blood cell that should not be there, and that is what a reticulocyte is. It is an immature red blood cell, and you can visualize it by a supervital stain, which allows you to look for nuclear remnants. Now, when it comes to our body is producing red blood cells normally, and because of that normal production, you're going to have some level of normal reticulocytosis. And that doesn't mean you have an infection or you have an increased level of reticulocytes, You are going to have a normal level of reticulocytes. Your body just ends up letting some reticulocytes through the bone marrow, and that's going to lead to a 1-2% amount of reticulocytes in your red blood cell count. Now, you can also have an increased reticulocyte count with anemias. So in anemias, keep in mind, you don't have enough red blood cells circulating, or you don't have enough oxygen getting to your body, and your body's going to say, whoa, we got to ramp up production of red blood cells. Let's get going. Let's put this factory to work. Now, because you are producing so much more when it comes to red blood cells, you are going to have more reticulocytes leaving the bone marrow than they should, and that can lead to an increase in your reticulocyte count. So in anemia, you're going to have to a 4-5% increase, 4-5% of your red blood cells will show you an anemia. And it can be even higher than this. Keep that in mind. Reticulocyte count doesn't mean it's just going to be 4-5%. If it's severe anemia, you'll have even a higher reticulocyte count. So in non-hemolytic anemia, in non-hemolytic normocytic anemia, you're going to have a reticulocyte count that is going to be less than or equal to 2%. Why is that? Well, mainly in these cases, you are just having a less decreased production of red blood cell. That's what's happening in aplastic anemia, anemia of chronic disease, and in a chronic kidney disease as well. You are just reducing the amount of red blood cells that are being produced, and therefore you are not releasing more reticulocytes because your bone marrow is not producing a lot of red blood cells. So you may see a normal reticulocyte count. And then in hemolytic anemia, because you are lysing red blood cells, because they are being burst, your body realizes, oh snap, we are breaking red blood cells. We need to amp up the production of our red blood cells in our bone marrow. And that's where you're going to see specifically the increase in reticulocyte count. And in normocytic anemias, specifically hemolytic anemias, if you see an increase in reticulocyte count, you will know that this is going to be a hemolytic anemia. Not a normocytic anemia that is non-hemolytic. You have a hemolytic anemia that's occurring. Now, in order to understand if this response, this number, this reticulocyte number is adequate, we have to look at our bone marrow. And we have to look at whether or not the response to anemia is adequate. So we must correct for anemia. We must correct for the reticulocyte count when it comes to anemia, because we have to look at adequate bone marrow response. If the reticulocyte count, the corrected reticulocyte, is less than 2%. If it's still less than 2%, right, which means it's not producing enough red blood cells, then that means your bone marrow has an inadequate response. When you correct for reticulocyte in the presence of anemia and your corrected reticulocyte count comes down to be normal, in the normal ranges, that is not normal, right? Because you have an issue and your body, your bone marrow is producing the same amount of red blood cells. So therefore, your bone marrow is not functioning properly. So the formula you need to remember is going to be anemia of reticulocyte count times your hematocrit in anemia and your normal hematocrit. Commit this to memory, because if it is less than 2%, it will not show adequate response in your bone marrow. So that is very important. So let's just work this out. It helps to have some examples. So let's do an example. Let's say you have an anemia where you have a reticulocyte count of 8% and a hematocrit of 11%. Well, your normal reticulocyte should be 1%, right? Because 1 to 2%. And your hematocrit should be 45. So is this an adequate response for your bone marrow? Well, let's look. Let's do the formula. So you have 0.08. right, for your reticulocyte, anemia reticulocyte count, times 11, which is your anemia hematocrit, divided by 45. And this will tell you that you have 0.0195, and you can round that to 0.02. This is 2%. Now, remember, if you have less than 2%, you have inadequate response. And if it is greater than 2%, it is normal response. We can see that this is towards the lower end of the gamma, but as far as we are concerned, we have a normal, adequate response to the anemia that's happening. Your bone marrow is producing normal amounts of red blood cells that it should, given what's happening. Now, when it comes to reticulocytes, you also need to know the reticulocyte production index. This is used to correct for longer reticulocyte life in anemia. Keep that in mind. We have a higher life that's happening for reticulocytes. Immature reticulocytes that are released have a longer life, and they last longer than normal reticulocytes. And therefore, we need to know another of these formulas, which is very simple. Once you do the corrected reticulocyte count, you can divide that by the maturation time, and that will let you know your RPI, your reticulocyte production index. This is, I think, more lower yield than the corrected the reticulocyte count. So more so, you should focus on the corrected reticulocyte count. Now, let's talk about intravascular and extravascular hemolysis. Intravascular hemolysis means it is happening within your blood vessels. Okay, that is where the hemolysis is happening. And then extravascular hemolysis occurs mainly in your spleen. That is where it's happening, in the red pulp. So let's talk about intravascular hemolysis and what you're going to see. When it comes to intravascular hemolysis, you are going to see cysticites because your red blood cells are lysing in your blood vasculature, and you will see Heme cells, aka cysticites, in this smear, the red blood cell smear. Now, because you are lysing red blood cells, you are releasing hemoglobin, you are going to have a significant decrease in your haptoglobin. Haptoglobin is going to bind to hemoglobin in the blood, and it's going to take it to your liver, where it gets broken down, and it's going to aid in the removal of hemoglobin. Now, because you are having such an increased amount of hemoglobin that's going into circulation in your blood that shouldn't be, you are going to have an increase in unconjugated bilirubin. Why is that the case? Well, when it comes to hemoglobin, right? Hemoglobin, the heme molecule is going to be broken down. Hemoglobin is going to be broken down based off of an enzyme, called heme oxidase, and that's going to lead to the production of unconjugated bilirubin, right? That's what's happening no matter what. You have hemoglobin circulating, it's going to be broken down into unconjugated bilirubin first off. Then the unconjugated bilirubin is going to be bound to albumin and glucuronic acid via UGT, and that's going to lead to conjugated bilirubin in the liver, right? Your liver is going to conjugate that bilirubin. Now, because you are having intravascular hemolysis, because you are releasing so much hemoglobin that you normally don't, you are going to over saturate the capacity of the liver to create the conjugated bilirubin. So you will have an increase in unconjugated bilirubin as well as normal conjugated bilirubin that's occurring. So, and in that case, you will see hemoglobinuria because the hemoglobin is going to be going through your urine. It's going to be, you're going to urinate it out. You're going to see hemosiderinuria, okay? So you're also going to see that hemosiderin. And then you're also going to see urobilinogen in your urine. Why are you going to see urobilinogen in your urine? Because even though you have an increase in unconjugated bilirubin, your body is releasing so much bilirubin that it is going to release it is going to actually still conjugate that bilirubin in the liver. You are simply oversaturating the ability for the liver to conjugate it, and that's why you get the unconjugated bilirubin. Now, the conjugated bilirubin is then going to go to the intestine, where it's going to be broken down into urobilinogen, and from there it's going to be broken down into urobilinogen, and it's going to be urinated out. That's what's happening. Your body has so much hemoglobin that your whole production and excretion of the substances that come from hemoglobin are being oversaturated, and that's why you're going to find these findings in intravascular hemolysis. Now, when it comes to extravascular hemolysis, keep in mind this is happening in the spleen, and you're going to have normal haptoglobin levels because of that. The spleen is going to take care of everything. Just simplify it for yourself. Spleen takes care of everything. You're going to see no hemoglobin going into circulation into the blood, and therefore you're going to see normal haptoglobin levels. You are going to see spherocytes that are going to come up, and you're not going to have any hemoglobinuria or hemosiderinuria because of the fact that no hemoglobin is actually being released into circulation. You're not going to have increase in your unconjugated bilirubin levels, etc., etc. What you will see, and what patients can't present with is going to be urobilinogen in the urine. Your heme is still going to be removed in one way or another, and because of that removal, urobilinogen in the intestines is going to go out through our urine. And that is what you are going to see in intravascular and extravascular hemolysis. Now, this was a doozy. There was a lot of stuff you got to go through. Mainly, just understand that the reticulocyte count will be increased in hemolytic anemias compared to non-hemolytic anemias. And also, don't forget the reticulocyte correction formula. And then finally, don't forget these findings. We will go over them deeper when it comes to each of these intravascular and extravascular hemolysis videos. Now, with that being said, thank you so much for watching. I hope this was beneficial. And don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Follow us on Instagram at mad.medicine, on Twitter at itsmadmedicine. And you can find these lectures on your favorite podcast service for free. Just search Mad Medicine and we'll pop up.